Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Anne Brockmeyer, and I'm an associate director at the Institute for Fiscal Studies, and I lead the Tax and Development Group at IFS. Our speaker today is Vedanth Nair, who is a research economist at the IFS, and more specifically at the Tax Dev Center, the Center for Tax Analysis in Developing Countries. And Vedanth will speak today about how developing countries can raise more tax revenue. Now, this event is part of the ESRC Festival of Social Sciences, and we're very grateful to the ESRC for funding. Just a few pointers on the logistics. So Vedanth will speak for about 30 minutes. After that, we will have a Q&A, during which we will take questions from Slido. So you can either post questions in Slido, or even if you don't have a question to ask yourself, you can follow the questions that are posted there and then vote or like the ones that you find important. And that allows us to identify and collect the most popular questions. The link for the Slido page will be in the chat. So with that, let me thank you again for joining us today and hand over to Vedanth. Vedanth, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Anne, and thank you everyone for coming. So my name is Vedanth. I'm a research economist, and as Anne said, I work in tax dev specifically within the IFS. And we at tax dev, we're a little bit different to the rest of the IFS. We work directly with governments in low-income countries, specifically Ethiopia, Ghana, Rwanda, and Uganda, advising them on tax policy and supporting capacity building. I also do some more research work in this field. So I guess this is a field where I have a bit of perspective from the policy boots on the ground angle and also a more high level research angle. So the question today is how and why should developing countries raise more tax revenue? I think the why is actually the easiest. The why is the easiest part of the two questions. Developing countries don't raise a lot of tax revenue, have strong needs for tax revenue, and perhaps raising tax revenue can also strengthen the social contract between citizens and the state. So, you know, perhaps that's the easiest part of the formula. Why don't developing countries raise a lot of tax revenue? Partly it's because developing countries are characterized by high levels of informality. So there's a large part of the economy, large part of production, that's completely out of reach of the government and that the government can't even tax. There's also a high level of evasion amongst firms within the formal economy. So large part of the economy outside the tax net, within the tax net, a large number of firms aren't paying the tax that they should do. So what can we do? What can developing countries do to raise more tax revenue? And certainly, you know, maybe I don't know where this audience is geographically, but certainly in the UK, when we think, what can we do to raise more tax revenue? It's really a question of what rate should we put up? You know, what rate should we put up on? Should we increase the income tax rate? Should we increase the national insurance tax rate? Should we increase the corporation tax rate? It's a question of tax rates. It isn't as simple in low-income countries. Low-income countries broadly have the same tax rates as high-income countries for most tax. In low-income countries, it's really about improving tax administration, improving the nuts and bolts of tax collection, making tax collection more efficient and reducing the possibility for evasion. So I'm going to talk about a couple of studies that aim to improve tax administration. And it's also about rethinking tax policy. We can't take the same tax design, the same tax structures from high-income countries and expect them to work in economies with such high levels of informality and evasion. So we're also going to have to rethink how we do tax policy in order to create better taxes and raise more revenue. So first question, why should developing countries raise more tax revenue? And you know, this is the killer graph. In the UK, we raise 35% of our GDP in taxes, a little bit more in other European countries like France. In the countries we work in, Uganda, Rwanda, that number is between 10 and 20%. And when we go, then we talk to people in the government, you know, pretty much everyone in the government shares the same goal, which is they want to increase this number so they can fund education, they can fund health, they can fund crucial investments in the development process. So yeah, developing countries have a strong need to raise tax revenue, a strong need to raise tax to GDP. You know, you might not care about developing countries, but certainly the UK, if you're sitting in the UK, you certainly want developing countries to raise more tax revenue because the UK spends a lot of money on aid. And to some extent, you'd like in the long run, aid spending to go down and increase and developing countries to collect more tax revenue domestically. So we need more taxes to fund development, to reduce reliance on aid. There's also an interesting subfield of the literature looking at how taxation itself contributes to democracy, contributes to development. So this is, you know, there's an old saying coming from the American Revolution, no taxation without representation. And a lot of historians have sort of looked at the growth of the state in Europe, growth of democracy and the growth of the social contract in Europe to the need to raise taxes. So governments needed to raise taxes and governments need to raise taxes. And as a bargain for that, there was a growth in democracy and a growth in the development of the modern state. And that's a nice historical theory. Is that still happening today? And I think there's a really nice paper that looks at this in the context of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, the DRC. So in the one city in the DRC, there was this property tax. It wasn't being collected at all. And in 2016, 2017, they decided to start collecting it because revenues from resource taxes, which the local government mostly relied on in this part of the world, were falling. So the authors managed to convince the government to randomize the collection of this property tax. So in half of the neighborhoods within the city, they didn't send out tax collectors. So property tax compliance was something like 0.1%. So no one paid this tax. In the neighborhoods where they sent out tax collectors to, property tax compliance rose to 11.6%. I mean, it doesn't sound great, but apparently that's the average for property taxes in sub-Saharan Africa because you have a lot of informal settlements, etc. So it certainly seemed like this property tax collection scheme kind of worked. It raised compliance in the neighborhoods where you sent tax collectors out to. But that's not the really interesting part of this paper. The really interesting part of this paper is that citizens from the neighborhoods where they sent the property tax collectors to, where there was an increase in tax collection, were 31% more likely to attend one of the town hall meetings the local government held. So suddenly when these people started being taxed, they went to town hall meetings and they actually recorded what they said, what the questions in town hall meetings were. They started to talk about things like, you know, okay, I'm paying these taxes. I want to see an improvement in the quality of public goods. I want to see reduction in corruption. I want to see an increase in government effectiveness. So it seems like taxes, yes, we need taxes to fund the modern state, but taxes also have, you know, unintended benefits in terms of improving the social contract, potentially improving the growth of democracy. So yeah, that's the why of taxation, why we need to raise taxation. How are developing countries different? Why don't they raise as much taxes in high-income countries? Now, I think developing countries are different in obviously a lot of ways. From the perspective of taxation, I think there are two important things. The first is that developing countries are characterized by a high level of informality. So this is the informal economy is a share of GDP. Across GDP per capita. So in the lowest countries, the lowest income countries, 40% of the economy, 50% of the economy is informal. What does informal mean? A lot of people think it's criminality, drugs and prostitution and things like that, which it mostly is in high income countries. In low income countries, informality is stuff like people relying on subsistence agriculture, so growing food for themselves, people selling things at the side of the street, small firms, artisan production, you know, really small production, small scale production that is very difficult for the government to tax. So you can effectively think of these as completely outside the tax net for the government. The government can't reach these people. So I said 40% of the economy is in informal production. When you look at employment, 90% of employees work in the informal sector in the lowest income countries. So you have a lot of the economy that's completely out of reach of the government, really. even within the formal economy, even within the sort of businesses that you manage to convince to register for taxation, to comply with, you know, rules and regulations, people that you even amongst the businesses, small number of businesses that you do manage to convince to join the tax net, there's a high level of evasion. So this graph comes from some research my co-authors actually did in Pakistan. So they looked at they took the list of taxpayers, they selected some at random and audited them. And they found out at the 50th size percentile, so the median firm, the medium-sized firm, almost 60% of firms were evading. They were misreporting in some way. They were paying less tax than they should have given their sales and purchases. Which is incredible. That means, you know, if you pick a firm at random, you've got a more than 50% chance that firm is going to be evading. Generally, smaller formal firms evade more than the larger formal firms. So the government faces two challenges. A lot of the economy just outside its reach at all. And even in the part of the economy that's within the government's tax net, there's high levels of evasion. Okay, so what are we going to do about that? How do we increase revenue given these factors? I think a really important part of that is improving tax administration. So tax administration, you can think of as the nuts and bolts of collecting taxes, the going out and registering businesses and making sure they pay the right amount of taxes. That's somewhat separate from tax policy, which looks at the structure and design of the tax system. In the UK, the Treasury sets the tax rates and the tax bases. So that's tax policy. And it's left to HMRC to actually go out and collect the taxes. And in the UK, well, you know, the Treasury makes all the headlines. You don't really hear about HMRC as much because it kind of does its job quickly and efficiently. In lower-income countries, tax administration, the actual how you collect the taxes, is much more important given these high levels of evasion. I mentioned we do some work in Ethiopia. So in Ethiopia, the tax administration, the Ministry of Revenues, reports directly to the Prime Minister. It's not subservient to the Treasury like it is in the UK. So the government places a very crucial emphasis on tax administration. Now, we want to improve tax administration to reduce tax evasion. There's a high level of tax evasion even amongst formal firms. Now, when we think about tax evasion, in economic context, tax evaders aren't stupid people. They're going to balance the benefits of evasion against the costs of evasion. Benefits of evasion are, you know, the obviously not paying any taxes. The cost of evasion are the probability of getting detected times the fine you're going to get if you get caught. So how can the government sort of change that equation, make evasion less beneficial and increase the cost of evasion? Obviously, there are a lot of ways they can do that. I'm going to look at just two ways, given time constraints. We can look at third-party information. So instead of relying on taxpayers to self-declare how much they owe, get other people, other businesses, consumers, banks to report information on your reported tax liability. This makes it easier for the tax authority to detect evaders. You can also look at withholding. So withholding works by just reducing the amount a firm can evade, which limits the benefits of evasion. And I'm going to explain what these mean in a lot more detail. They're a bit jargony and a bit technical. And I'm going to look at two empirical studies that have applied this in the real world and show very promising results. So the first study I'm going to look at looks at third-party information in the context of a VAT. So obviously third-party information can work with any tax, but I think it's very interesting in the context of a VAT. But first, I'm going to just have to briefly explain how a VAT works. A VAT is a value-added tax. And one way to think about it is to think about a production chain. Firm A sells to firm B, which sells to firm C, which sells to the consumer. So firm A is like the manufacturer, firm B is the wholesaler, firm C is the retailer, and then the retailer sells to the consumer. This is just an example chain, but say firm A makes 100 in sales, 0 in purchases, it pays, say the tax rate's 20%, it pays 20% output VAT on its sales and doesn't have any purchases, so it doesn't have any input VAT. Firm B makes 300 in sales, say, and has 100 in purchases from firm A. It pays 20% of 300, so 60 on its outputs. And crucially, and this is the interesting thing about the VAT, it can reclaim the VAT that it paid on its purchases. So it can reclaim 20 pounds of the 20% of the 100 pounds in purchases that it paid on its transaction from firm A. So you pay VAT on your outputs and you reclaim input VAT paid on your inputs. So your net VAT is the difference between this and this column. So that's how the VAT works. And you might think, okay, why have this sort of, you know, this seems quite complicated. Why set up, you know, why not just have a simple sales tax? A VAT is nice because for business-to-business transactions, you have an inbuilt third-party reporting mechanism. What does that mean? It means that firm A's output VAT is going to be the same as firm B's input VAT. So both firm A and firm B report the value of the transaction. So the tax authority, when it wants to check whether firm A is paying the right amount in tax, it can check, okay, well, if firm A is declaring 20 pounds of output VAT, is firm B declaring 20 pounds of input VAT? If not, there's a problem. If likewise, if firm B is declaring 60 pounds of output VAT, is firm C declaring 60 pounds in input VAT? If not, there's a problem. So firm B provides third-party information about firm A to the tax authority. Likewise, for firm A providing third-party information to firm B to the tax authority. And you might think, okay, you know, maybe these firms can collude or something. But collusion is made very difficult by the fact that if firm A wants to evade, it's going to want to reduce how much output VAT it has. It wants to underreport its sales. Whereas if firm B wants to evade, it wants to overreport its inputs because your total tax liability is your output VAT minus your input VAT. So firm B wants to overreport that, firm A wants to unreport that. So it's going to be very difficult to come to some sort of collusion agreement. So a VAT is nice. And one reason it's seen such fast adoption in developing countries is that at least for business to business transactions, there's each transaction is reported twice. So the tax authority can use that data to check whether firms are evading. And in many countries, it does check that data. In many countries, it doesn't, and we'll come to that. Now, you might have noticed that firm C's outputs aren't covered by anything. So firm C can underreport its output VAT, and the tax authority is none the wiser because it doesn't have any other source of information on except for firm C's own declaration. So firm C can say, oh, no, I didn't pay 180 pounds in output VAT. I only made 60 or only made zero. So we have this sort of loss of third-party information for firm C. What are we going to do about it? So this paper studies an interesting context in Sao Paulo. It basically says, okay, for all the other bits of the VAT chain, other firms provide third-party information on each other. The consumers are doing nothing. How about let's bring the consumers into this process? We'll incentivize consumers to ask for and send in receipts. So consumers will get receipts from the retailers, from the firm C's, and send them into the tax authority. And how are we going to incentivize consumers to do that? The solution they went for in this context was a lottery. I don't know exactly why. Maybe Brazilians love gambling, but so consumers in Sao Paulo who get VAT receipts and then send them into the tax authority are entered into a lottery. And then, you know, there are a variety of prizes, and some prizes as small as $5, some prizes are bigger. It seemed to be very popular. It seemed to be very salient. How are we going to evaluate the impact of this program on VAT revenues? We're going to use what we call a difference in difference. And basically with a difference in difference, we can't just compare sort of retailers before and after, because there are a lot of the red line is the introduction of the reform, it's very hard to see whether this black line, the retailers, you know, was there more revenue growth after the reform or before? You know, it seems that the trend rate was growing. So, you know, how do we actually evaluate the effect of the policy? So the idea with difference in difference is we find a suitable control group. So wholesalers weren't directly affected by the policy because consumers don't buy directly from wholesalers. So they're not going to be affected by the increase in third-party reporting that these consumer lotteries, that these incentives to ask for receipts are going to provide. Wholesalers, you can imagine, were firm B in this last example. So firm B is already covered by third-party reporting from firm A and firm C. So wholesalers are a suitable control group because they, you know, it seems like before the reform, they're growing at the same trend. Retailers and wholesalers face the same macroeconomic conditions, but aren't affected directly by the reform. And you can see by the divergence between the black and the gray line, it seems that after the reform, retailers' revenue growth was much larger than wholesalers' revenue growth. This suggests that the reform seemed to work. It suggests that consumers asking for receipts seem to increase reported tax revenue amongst retailers, because now retailers know the government are checking their receipts that consumers are sending in. It's going to be much harder to evade. If you actually calculate the difference between the dark black line and the gray line, it increased tax liability by 26%. Obviously, you have to you lose a bit of money because you're paying out the lottery rewards, but still you're increasing tax revenue amongst retailers by 10%. And you know, maybe that doesn't sound like a lot, but certainly 10%, if you ask anyone working in tax administration in a low-income country, you know, they'll bite your hand off for 10%. It's actually quite a substantial increase for not a very costly or difficult to administer policy. So in this context, third-party information appears to be successful. And of course, they went for using consumer lotteries in the end. That's not the only way to generate third-party information. For example, third-party information can also be generated by electronic payments. So consumers increasingly are paying by cards, that's both in the developed and developing world. Can credit card companies report the value of the transaction to the tax authority? That's third-party information. You know, if you the stereotype is that, you know, if you hire a builder, they're gonna they might give you a discount if you pay in cash. That's likely because paying in cash means that the bank or the credit card company doesn't see the value of the transaction, and it's easier for the builder to evade taxes. That's a problem that exists in high-income countries as well. Obviously, third-party information doesn't just work in isolation. You know, just creating this information doesn't work. The tax authority actually has to act on it. So I've showed you in the graph that you know, there should be third-party information between firm A and firm B and firm B and firm C. So B2B transactions under the VAT are already covered by third-party information. And turns out in countries like Uganda and Rwanda and a lot of other low-income countries, this data exists, but the tax authority don't use it because they don't have the capacity or know-how to actually use this data for the audit process. So third-party information only works if the government actually, if firms believe that the government is going to use that data. Otherwise, it's just additional compliance costs. Okay, so we looked at third-party information. That's going to try and make it easier for the government to find out who the tax evaders are, increase the probability of detection. Withholding is a little bit different. So withholding, what you're doing is you're changing who's legally responsible for paying the tax. And it might sound like a bit of a jargony term, but everyone has probably come into contact with the withholding system. In pretty much all countries, personal income taxes are going to be withheld by your employer. So the IFS pays me every month, but I don't actually pay income tax myself. The IFS deducts it on my behalf. So we can say here that the IFS is the withholding agent. They're sort of withholding taxes from me. Withholding has existed for a long time within personal income taxes. It's one reason why, say, tax evasion amongst employed people is lower than tax evasion from self-employed people. Self-employed people file their own tax returns. It's a self-declaration. They're not being withheld by an employer, which means that it's easier for them to evade. Increasingly in developing countries, business taxes are also being subject to withholding, so moving beyond personal income taxes. So firms, certain large firms, which we don't think are likely to evade, so governments, credit card firms, are increasingly acting as withholding agents for their suppliers and their consumers. The goal here is to reduce the amount that small firms can evade. And maybe it'll be a bit clearer with an example. So let's assume that all small firms evade 50% of their taxes, whereas large firms don't evade any tax. They're just, this is just for the purpose of the model, but certainly we have that evidence from the introduction that small firms are more likely to evade than large firms. Now assume that there's a sales tax of 20%. Again, withholding can apply to any tax, but the paper I'm going to talk about is in the context of a sales tax. So let's just imagine that there's a sales tax of 20%. So the small firm sells 100 pounds of things to the large firm, pays 20 pounds in sales tax. The difference between a sales tax and a VAT is that there's no input rebate, but that isn't that important. Owes 20 pounds in sales tax, but it's going to evade 50% of the taxes because it's a small firm and small firms evade more. So it only pays 10 pounds in taxes. Now say the government is like, okay, we think small firms are more likely to evade than large firms. Let's appoint the large firm as a withholding agent. So the withholding agent is legally liable for paying the tax of its suppliers. So here, same thing's happening. A small firm is making 100 pounds in sales to the large firm, but the small firm doesn't have to pay any taxes. The large firm is now responsible for paying the taxes that the small firm previously had to pay. So the large firm pays a sales tax on that transaction. So the large firm pays 20 pounds in sales tax. And because the large firm doesn't evade, the tax owed is the same as the tax paid. That's the idea of withholding. You're going to make it you're not going to give small firms, you're not going to give certain taxpayers who you think are more likely to tax evade the opportunity to tax evade. So again, there's a nice paper here by actually one of our colleagues at TaxDev in the context of the sales tax in Buenos Aires. So in Buenos Aires, just as theory predicts, you're going to designate certain large firms as withholding agents. They're going to have to collect the sales taxes made on sales by smaller firms to them. Again, it's another diff and diff. So the treatment group are the small firms or the trading partners of firms. I think I've got the treatment and control the wrong way. Apologies for the typo. The treatment is trading partners of firms that are required to withhold. So the small firms are now find themselves selling to withholding agents, and the controls are trading partners of firms that are not required to withhold. So the red line is firms which sell to non-withholding agents. The blue line is small firms which sell to withholding agents. And again, the reform seems to have been pretty successful. When comparing the treatment group to the control group, the difference between the blue and the red line, it seems that there was an increase in tax paid by about 5.5%. Again, a pretty big number, given that it's a pretty big number in the context of tax administration studies. And it seems to be the mechanism is that you're sort of limiting the opportunity for small firms to evade. And this is in Buenos Aires, but there's evidence withholding works from other contexts. Anne's actually done some studies on that. So within tax administration, we've looked at third-party reporting, we've looked at withholding. There's a lot of stuff I didn't have time to talk about. We can talk about sort of how we target scarce audit resources, how we can best use technology. It's a really growing and interesting field. But let's move on to how we rethink tax policy. Because of course, tax administration, how we collect the tax is important. We also need to rethink how we structure and design the tax system in low-income countries. Often the case is in low-income countries, the actual design of the tax is very similar to those in high-income So the design of a VAT of the VAT in Ethiopia is fairly similar to the design of the VAT in the UK or the design of the VAT in France. That's despite the fact that we have these huge amounts of evasion and informality. So how do we reconsider how we design tax policy in a high evasion, high informality context? I'm only going to use one example. I'm going to talk about how we should reconsider how we use VAT exemptions as a tool for achieving equity, as a tool for redistribution in low-income countries, given high levels of informality. In both high and low-income countries, we have VAT exemptions for food. That's a deliberate policy choice because the poor spend more as a percentage of their income on food than the rich. Again, true in both high and low-income countries. So policymakers think, okay, we want the tax system to achieve equity. We want to redistribute. We don't want the tax system to be an overly burdensome on the poor. How we redistribute them? Okay, VAT exemptions, which will reduce the price of food. Hopefully that benefits the poor more than the rich. That's a statement that's true in high-income countries. VAT exemptions generally benefit the poor more than the rich, so you can say that they're progressive in high-income countries. That sort of breaks down in low-income. Well, first, it's important to say, you know, this is a very costly policy. You know, we're forgoing 25 to 40% of VAT revenue, so it's very costly to give out these VAT exemptions. And the problem is, in low-income countries, we run into the barrier of informality. We can't do the same thing as a high-income country because we have high levels of informality. In particular, the poor are going to consume their food from informal sources. They're going to consume from, they might grow the food themselves. They might consume from sort of street vendors on the side of the street who aren't in the tax net. Therefore, if you make food VAT exempt, that only targets people who buy their food from supermarkets and formal stores, which sort of pay VAT, which means that it's actually not a very good way to redistribute. It'd be better to remove VAT exemptions, raise more revenue, and then spend the money on public goods or cash transfers. And an interesting paper that looks at this, looks at the share of food consumption, again, focusing on food, because in pretty much all countries, it's VAT exempt, or there's a reduced rate or some sort of discount for food. Share of food consumption in the informal sector across countries. So generally in poorer countries, there's a higher share of food being consumed in the informal sector. And in like the Congo and Burundi, it's close to 100%. In like Ecuador, it's like 80% of food is consumed from the informal sector. So these are basically food not consumed from supermarkets, from sort of side of the street, self-production. This is across countries, but it also holds within countries as well. So within countries, the richest people are the most likely to buy food from formal sources, poorest overwhelmingly buy food from informal sources. So VAT exemptions on food are at best flat and at worst regressive, because they benefit the richest who purchase from the formal sector. These authors also looked at what would happen if, what VAT rate would we set if we want to, what VAT rate would we set on food if we want to, if our goal is redistribution. And it turns out it's the opposite of what we're actually doing. So in reality, we're setting a low VAT rate on food. If we want to redistribute, we want to set a higher VAT rate on food in countries where there's more food being consumed from the informal sector, because it targets the richer people who purchase it from the formal sector, and then you can use that money to redistribute in other ways through public good provision, through cash transfers. This is an example of how the redistribution by the VAT, achieving equity in the tax system, is constrained by informality. We can talk about dozens of examples about how what might work well in a high-income tax system breaks down in a low-income tax system. You know, corporation taxes might work well in a high-income tax system. So might work well in a high income system. But when we take that to low income countries, it might turn out that corporation taxes are easier to evade. There's a high level of evasion. It might be better to have simpler taxes. So that's something that Anne and her co-authors have looked at. So yeah, I've just focused on this one example in the interest of time. Okay, so to conclude, we know that increasing tax to GDP is a key goal in developing countries. A lot of people in the government say that. We think that developing countries have urgent needs to invest in revenue, invest in infrastructure, human capital, education. Increasing tax might bring sort of other unintended consequences in terms of improving democracy, strengthening the social contract. Low-income countries are characterized by high levels of informality and high levels of evasion. That's going to make it difficult for them to raise tax revenue. That's going to mean we can't do exactly the same thing as we do in high-income countries. When we look into what works in terms of raising tax revenue, improvements in tax administration are key. People often forget about tax administration in high-income countries. In low-income countries, they're often the most important thing. I've shown you two studies, one on third-party information, third-party reporting in the case of a VAT, one on withholding in the context of a sales tax. To some extent, we might also need to change policy to account for high levels of evasion and formality. So I showed you how we need to change policy on VAT exemptions, given the high level of informal food purchases. And obviously, tax and development is a very big field. We haven't talked about how we tax multinationals in developing countries, how we tax trade, how we tax high net worth individuals in developing countries. There's a lot of interesting research there. But I'll finish by just saying tax and development is a field I've been working in for a few years now, and it's certainly fascinating from a research perspective. There's a lot of new papers. I mean, if you notice, like, a lot of dates on the papers were published in the last 3 or 4 years. There's still a lot we don't know, which makes it very interesting from a research perspective. The fact that there's a lot we don't know also means it's very challenging from a policy perspective. It's often difficult to know what the right thing to do is because we don't have the data and we don't necessarily know what works in every context. So I'll finish on that and hand back to Anne. We hopefully have some questions.
Thank you, Vedanth. That was very interesting and a really great overview of the diversity of the landscape of research in this area, and also the open policy and research questions that we still need to tackle. We have a couple of questions in the chat. Let me maybe start with the two questions that I think are kind of, the first one is highest ranking and the second one I think is quite specific. So the first question is by Guillermo about the role of technology in tackling tax evasion. So maybe you could talk a little bit about the role of technology in general. And then there's a specific sub question about the experience in countries engaging in blockchain technology to track taxes.
Okay. Certainly the role of technology in tackling tax evasion is very fascinating, and there's a lot we could talk about. I mentioned maybe it's best to go back to the third-party reporting slide. So third-party information takes a lot of forms. In the context I talked about, it was pretty simple. It was literally consumers are asking for receipts and then sending it into the tax authorities. So it's pretty analog. But we can do some more fancier things. So I briefly talked about how electronic payments, and I guess that's a facet of technology, also provide a source of third-party information. Increasingly in low-income countries, we see sort of electronic billing machines. So these are sort of machines which the tax authority sends to firms. You can pay by card or cash, but by registering the transaction is automatically registered in this billing machine and sent in real time to the tax authority. So technology opens the door for increased third-party information. Of course, third-party information doesn't work in isolation. As I said, the government having this new data that technology provides doesn't mean that evasion is going to go away overnight. The government needs to invest in capacity and skills and resources to actually analyze that data, cross-check the receipts from different firms, you know, create the sort of data pipes that can sort of reduce evasion. So that's one way technology can sort of reduce tax evasion. And a paper by Anne, and you know, I guess Anne's sort of the expert in the papers that she writes, but I can sort of summarize myself. So Anne had a really fascinating research question, which was to look at audits. So I didn't talk about audits here so much, but audits is generally pretty effective. When 60% of firms on average are evading, it's pretty easy to find some firms that are evading, recovering some revenue. The problem is you have limited resources. Because you know it's hard to find skilled auditors in different countries. They have a good outside option. They could work in accountancy. So it's, you know, you don't have that much money to pay them well. So generally you have fewer auditors than you may really want. So it's really a question about how you target those scarce audit resources. So Anne and her co-authors developed an algorithm based on sort of econometrics and sort of fancy techniques that tried to select which firms are the best for the human auditors to audit. So it's a question of how can we use the algorithm to target scarce audit resources. And it turns out that the algorithm performed worse than humans in selecting which firms you want to audit. So again, technology is not a panacea. In this case, the algorithm wasn't as good as the humans in selecting which firms to audit. In the case of third-party information, the technology can provide you with the data and can provide you with the information, but you still need humans with skills at some end to deal with that. So I guess it's about, to summarize, we need it. Technology works, but you need to combine it with state capacity, combine it with skills, human skills and data, etc. Now on blockchain, I don't know. Certainly, even in high-income countries, I'm not sure exactly how blockchain would be used to tackle tax evasion. Certainly, there are a lot of things that low-income countries can do to tackle tax evasion without resorting to blockchain. I'm sure someone's looking at it, but I don't know. I don't know if you want to add on that, Anne.
Thank you, Vedanth. No,
I think it's a great question, and I have seen quite a lot of discussions about how tax administrations can use blockchain technologies in various ways. I have not yet seen a thorough impact evaluation or any kind of even anecdotal experience on how that worked. So I think that's an area where we're going to see some results and policy implications coming out, hopefully in the next few years. Okay, so we have the Slido is very active, Vedanth. So I'll just field you the next two questions that have both several likes. So one question is about what HMRC should be doing to engage more with developing countries to tackle the tax compliance and tax revenue issues. And then the second question is about whether there are any standout papers that pull together these strategies for building tax capacity that you have been discussing.
Okay. So what can HMRC do? Well, HMRC already do a lot. I believe that they have partnerships with multiple countries in sub-Saharan Africa, similar to us, funded by the UK's aid budget, working with them to build tax capacity, working with them to improve tax administration. I think that's a good thing. Certainly, there are very technical areas within tax administration where I think HMRC have tended to focus on. So one thing I didn't talk about was transfer pricing. This is a bit of a technical area, but basically, one way multinationals avoid tax is by selling goods from the sub-affiliate of the multinational in country A to the sub-affiliate of the multinational in country B, and then over-reporting the value of the transaction, which makes it look like the multinational country A made zero profit and therefore didn't pay tax. So it's one of the mechanisms by which multinationals avoid tax. It's a very technical field. So basically, the way they do it is that they overprice the value of the transaction. So they might say that, oh yeah, we sold some goods to the other multinational. We sold it at this price because, you know, for stuff like, you know, oil or rice or flour, where there's a world market price, it's very easy to price that transaction. But if it's something like intellectual property or research and development, it's very difficult to know how much that transaction be priced. So within transfer pricing, there's a lot of scope for HMRC to, and they've been doing a lot of work on actually building capacity and building the technical knowledge on what is a very, very technical field in developing countries. I guess there's also a role for technology transfer. So HMRC have their own algorithms, which they use to detect tax evasion. Certainly Anne's paper suggests that, in low-income countries, it seems to be that humans are better detecting tax evasion than algorithms. Perhaps that's something, it's related to the structure of low-income countries where evasion is less easy to detect by an algorithm or there's less information available. But I'm sure there's certainly a lot of scope for technology transfer. So HMRC is already doing a lot. There's a lot of technical things to look at. Potentially technology transfer, algorithm transfer is one thing they can do. And in terms of the standout paper on tax administration, was it, Anne?
Yeah, I think it's a standout paper on generally the topics that you've covered, I guess, tax and development and tax compliance. There's a couple of review papers. Yeah. I can also maybe find some links and post them in the chat.
Yeah, so I mean, I don't have the links here, but certainly Tim Besley at the LSE has written a lot of review papers. Besley in person 2014 on tax and development in the Journal of Economic Perspectives is a good review paper and good for sort of getting into the topic. If you're interested in tax administration specifically, Joel Slemrod wrote a paper in the Journal of Economic Literature in 2019. I can't remember what it's called, something like a review of tax compliance, which looks at tax administration in both low and high income countries. I think that's a good paper in there. I don't know if you had any other recommendations, Anne.
No, exactly. Those are exactly the ones that I was thinking about. I just posted the link in the slides. Cool. Great. Okay, so let's continue to more questions as the chat is quite active. Okay, so let me again take two questions at a time because there's many. So first, a question about what are your thoughts on the trade-off between the neutrality of taxation and the reduction in evasion? So I guess that relates to the question of whether the tax system might need to be not neutral or potentially distortionary in order to combat evasion. Mm-hmm. And then another question is related to third-party data. So you mentioned that many low and middle-income countries do not use third-party data for enforcement because of capacity challenges. And from your experience in Ethiopia and Ghana, what do you see as priorities for strengthening tax administration?
Okay, so thoughts on the trade-off of between evasion and, I guess, efficiency. I should first start by saying tax evasion itself potentially compromises efficiency. If we think that tax evasion benefits businesses which aren't better at producing but better at evading, that's going to distort economic activity towards businesses which are better at evading, and business and towards sectors where it's easy to evade. So tax evasion itself, yes, it has a revenue cost, but it also has an efficiency cost. That said, there's been a lot of work looking at that said, there also does seem to be a trade-off between tax evasion and efficiency. So I guess a seminal paper here is by Anne, who's looked at the context of corporation taxes in Pakistan. So in Pakistan, there are two types of taxes on corporations. You have a standard corporate income tax, which is on which the tax base is profits. And you also have what we call a minimum turnover tax. So if you have a very low profit rate, you pay a tax on your sales, which is a broader base. So basically to stop people from reporting sort of zero profits and getting away with it. So you have this alternate tax on sales for firms with very low profit ratios, with very low ratios of profits to sales. The reason they do this, well, in general, we think taxes on profits are more economically efficient than taxes on sales. Why? Because a tax on pure economic profit, doesn't change firms' behavior. If a firm is maximizing its profits before the tax, it's going to maximize its profits after the tax. Now, to some extent, corporate income taxes aren't taxes on pure economic profit. They're really taxes on the returns to investment as well as pure economic profit. I mean, that's a debate which is probably going to be covered in another ESRC event. But generally, we think that taxes on profit are going to be more efficient than taxes on just sales, which is why we don't observe sales taxes in a high-income country. We'd rather tax profits and would rather tax sort of value added, which I guess is a sort of other alternative to sales tax. Whereas in low-income countries, we have the problem of evasion. In general, we think that's easier for firms to misreport their costs in a corporate income tax return. You know, you can overstate how much you've, lost in depreciation. You can overstate how much you paid in salaries. You can overstate how much, you've done in like research and development. You can sort of invent lots of things on the cost side. It's relatively harder to sort of invent things on the sales side because the sales are perhaps subject to third-party reporting, which is why you can justify the presence of a turnover tax as a backstop in Pakistan, because although a tax on sales isn't necessarily efficient, it's potentially harder to evade than a profit tax. So in that case, there's a trade-off between efficiency and evasion. And I'm summarizing your paper. I don't know if there's anything more you want to add there.
That was an excellent summary. And I just want to acknowledge also that the paper is with multiple co-authors. So yep. It's not just my own paper, but I think you summarized it very well. So there's, I think, more questions than we can cover in the remaining time. So let me again just take two at a time. So one question relates to the types of tax instruments that you find across countries. Are there any types of tax instruments that you typically find in low-income countries but not in high-income countries? And are there any taxes that might be uniquely suitable for low-income countries?
I have something in the appendix on that. So what type of tax instruments do we observe in low-income countries that we don't observe in high-income countries? I mean, to some extent, most of the main taxes, trade taxes, taxes on goods and services, which includes sort of VAT and excise, corporate taxes, personal income taxes, as shown on this graph, they exist in both low and high-income countries. So this is the share of tax revenue. This is the contribution of each tax to total tax revenue. Dark is low-income countries, light is high-income countries. There are some categories of taxation that we observe in low-income countries that we might not necessarily observe in high-income countries. people like Ben Olken have done a lot of work on like informal taxation. So this is like at the village level to fund sort of village services. Village elders might sort of impose a tax on each villager. You know, this is not something which the law necessarily allows, but it's something that sort of is commonly agreed at the village level. I guess you don't necessarily see this type of informal taxation being used in high-income countries to fund local public services. So maybe that's a sort of niche aside. But generally, it's more about sort of what taxes do we see more of and what taxes do we see less of. So generally, we see more taxes on trade and taxes that are levied on firms. Why? Because trade is relatively easy to tax. There are only a few sort of points in the border where goods come in and out. Yes, they're smuggling, but generally it's relatively easy to tax trade. Again, businesses, because businesses are, you know, typically large or subject to third-party reporting or subject to withholding, it's relatively easy to tax them, which is why you see more of a reliance on sort of business taxes. The real area where high-income countries have raised much more taxes than low-income countries are sort of personal income taxes. Part of that comes, part of that is because there's a lot of self-employment in low-income countries, a lot of informal employment in low-income countries, whereas, yeah, there's a lot of self-employment in low-income countries, a lot of informal employment in low-income countries. It's hard to tax that because that sort of tax base is, it's self-employed people find it easier to evade taxes, whereas generally in high-income countries, most people are employed. In high-income countries, most people are employed, in which case their income is subject to withholding by their employer. So it's relatively easier to tax that. So this graph shows that as the share of employment increases across development, which generally shows that the employee share of employment increases across levels of development. So there's less self-employment in low-income countries. And then you can also plot sort of income tax share as a percentage of total tax revenue, and it follows pretty much the same trend. So there does seem to be a link between employee share and the income tax share. And that's partly sort of a structural feature of the economy, which is hard for developing countries to change at the margin.
Great, thanks, Vedanth. So I think we have maybe 2 minutes left for the last question, which is somewhat related. So this audience member is struck by the effort that might be required to monitor collection of the VAT, and they think that surely there are more simpler ways to monitor collection or easier taxes to monitor. So, for instance, property or land value taxes, could they be an easy way to raise tax revenue because they're basically very easy to identify? It's easy to identify the taxpayers.
Certainly the VAT has high levels of compliance costs. Compliance costs are sort of, the compliance costs of dealing with the VAT is fixed. Therefore, you can imagine that the compliance costs of the VAT as a proportion of, say, sales are higher for smaller firms than larger firms, which is generally why you see quite high registration thresholds in low-income countries. So you generally, you know, because it's hard for small, because you don't want to deal with a lot of small taxpayers who don't contribute a lot in tax revenue, but you do have to deal with the compliance costs of registering them. The VAT, yes, it's complex to administer. So the trade-off there is, okay, we'll have a very high registration threshold relative to the size of firms. So we typically observe high registration thresholds for the VAT in low-income countries. But the point that the question makes is very good. Why don't we look at taxes which are relatively easy to enforce, like the property tax? To be honest, property tax is not my expertise, though I feel this is becoming a theme. Anne has a paper looking at how property taxes, looking at the sort of equity implications of property taxes in Mexico. And certainly, again, we need to think, okay, how do tax systems interact with structural features of the economy in Mexico? And I think my summary is not going to be very good, so come in, Anne. in Mexico, yes, property taxes are relatively easy to enforce because you can identify the property. I mean, certainly you need to spend a lot of effort sort of identifying the values of the property, so it's not necessarily costless to enforce. But it hits poor people particularly hard, because although poor people might live in houses that are worth a lot, or you know, might have a sort of street, because poor people might live in houses that get charged a high property tax because they were assessed as having a high value, they lack liquidity. They can't borrow against the value of the house to fund the property tax. So they're relatively high. You have a lot of people in foreign countries who are maybe high wealth or high assessed wealth, but low income. So the property tax hits them hard because they can't sort of borrow against the, they can't sort of capitalize the value of their property to pay for the property tax. Or maybe Anne might want to sort of butt in here.
No, I think that that was a great summary, because I'm realizing that we should be wrapping up, as people might have other lectures that they would like to attend. Thanks a lot, Vedanth, for this excellent presentation and for the discussion. Thanks to everybody for joining us and for the great questions. And we hope that you enjoy the rest of the ESRC Festival of Social Sciences. Thank you.
Thanks.